Moving on to the panel discussions, we have with us Mr. Ankit Kanchal.
Mr. Ankit Kanchal is a dynamic finance graduate with a master's in renewable energy sector with expertise in business development and project coordination with the world's third largest wind power company, Suzlon Energy Limited. With his acute business know-how and pulse of the industry, Mr. Kanchal has been an instigator behind Enbridge and spearheads the overall operations at Enbridge. A big round of applause for Mr. Ankit Kanchal.
I request Mr. Bharat Agarwal to kindly felicitate all our panelists for today. Our next panelist for today is Mr. Nandkishore Atal, a young man in his 20s who did not know the city, its language, or the topography. Within 2 years of being in Pune, started a company called VD Marketing. Later, in 2007, he established Shubhi Agro Industries, and the company's turnover increased from 12 crores to rupees 125 crores in just 4 years. Recently, he was also awarded the Vishesh Gaurav Puraskar 2012 from Pune Zilla Maheshwari Pragati Mandal. A big round of applause for Mr. Nandkishore Atal. Sir, please join us on stage.
Our next panelist for today is Mr. Vishal Agarwal. This versatile personality is the managing director of Bavaria Motors, which holds exclusive dealership of BMW. He also owns a franchise of Maruti Suzuki. Put your hands together for Mr. Vishal Agarwal. So please join us on stage.
Thank you, Bharat sir. Our moderator for today is Mr. Amit Bhalerao. He is a BE mechanical engineer from VIIT, currently pursuing management education in Mumbai. He also works for FMCG manufacturing firm and Bajaj Auto, and is a certified logistics and supply chain professional. It might also interest you to know that he is the former president of our very own entrepreneurship development cell. I request Mr. Bhalerao to kindly join us on stage and begin the proceedings right away.
Okay. A very entrepreneurial good morning to all of you. An eminent researcher, Paul Bayrog, has found that India was from 1 AD to 1750 AD, that means 1750 years, the largest contributor to the world economy, with a staggering GDP contribution of over 33%, while UK and US at that time were 0.8 and 1.8% contribution. The primary reason for this is that India was a hub of manufacturing and a home to many startups. Of course, at that time, they were not really known as startups. Then the Britishers started invading India, and over the next 200 years, our GDP contribution fell down to something less than 1.7%. And from hub of manufacturing, we also started importing something as small as a hairpin. So exactly after 265 years, after 1750, we have a prime minister who says that India would be the hub of manufacturing and a home to startups. And incidentally, India is also one of the fastest growing economies of the world. So we really need to understand that now we are not trying to achieve what we already have, but we are trying to regain the status which we had. With this food for thought, let us begin the panel discussion with opening comments from each of our panelists on their perception of growth, entrepreneurship, success mantra. So how do we begin? Should we follow the reverse alphabetical order? Vishal sir, will begin with you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to be part of this lovely event. And for me, like Amit said, as far as I am concerned, I feel there is no other country other than India which can give you such an amazing opportunity to become entrepreneur. You see, any other part of the world, people are only looking at what job can I do. No one is thinking, what business can I start? They are not even thinking. And here you all, when Barkha ma'am asked you how many people want to start their own business, almost everyone was up. So it's only in India we can start our own business and become successful. And for me, there's nothing better than this.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Then moving on to Nand Kishore, sir.
Hi. Good morning, everybody. Like Vishalji said, India is the best place to be in current scenario, because India is the youngest country in the world and the second most populated. We have market within our country, so there is many opportunities to be an entrepreneur, because it's a consumption story is India, and no other country has got so much of consumption in goods and services. So we are very, very fortunate that we are in this age, we are living in India. So it's a great opportunity. I wish everybody should encash it, and it's the right time. Thanks.
Okay. Ankit, sir.
Good morning, everybody. First of all, I would like to congratulate Vishwapreneur team. I just understand day before yesterday that they are doing this program since 2009 onwards. And it's a great thing to see such kind of management skills right from the invitation till coordination and now hosting this event, because this is one of the things which is required in entrepreneurship, the organizational skills. This team, I mean Amit and all, they have been inculcating this with their juniors and now taking ahead, so that's a real good thing. Secondly, talking about entrepreneurship is basically your capacity to deliver vision into reality. If you have a vision today, and if you are, I mean, all of you are planning to start a business, right? So you have a vision today. So if you have a vision today, you have to deliver that to a reality. And that is the basically entrepreneurship definition. You might be seeing a lot of hurdles in the days to come, but one good thing is that you are starting at a very good time. So all of you should feel really blessed that you are starting when the economy is going to take upward trend, because I remember I am also Vishwakarma pass out. When we started the business, there was a very downtrend in the economy. I was in a job. I did job till 2010. And just connecting to your yesterday's idea theme of ideation and business formulation and then prototyping. Yes. So I will just take two more minutes and quote them example of how we did this. When I was in a job, we were working with Suzlon Energy, We were into the business of, most of you must be knowing Suzlon, right? So they are into the turnkey solutions of wind energy. So that time we thought if same kind of concept can be applied across India in the solar industry, this can be a really a good business model. But that time solar was working into kilowatt scales. I mean a kilowatt or 2 kilowatt of some rooftop or some street light you can see. Otherwise there was no big installations. So we thought of this idea, and on this ideation we worked around 8 to 9 months continuously, me along with my friend. So we worked in detail on that. Later on, once we've thought that this can be done, this is doable, but yes, there will be a lot of challenges. So the next step was finance management. What was your yesterday scheme? So the next question comes, since this industry requires a lot of capex, I mean, a megawatt that time was 18 CR, and we were planning for a business of 100 megawatt in 4 years, which thankfully we have achieved till now. So megawatt that time was 18 CR, so we definitely needed some kind of big funding arrangement. So we did that arrangement. We had a channelized, and we have dealt and deal the entire structure. And then later on, we did the prototyping. So we commissioned the first megawatt in 2011. And thereon, you know, year on a year basis, we are growing. So the yesterday's event was very interesting. I would like to congratulate the team that they have kept the tone right. And today they will be discussing on the business strategies and the development that will be again giving good insight on the entrepreneurship.
All right, thank you, sir. And Barkha ma'am, anything else apart from what you have covered?
Yeah, I would just like to say that business is and entrepreneurship is more about passion. The more passionate you are about your business, and just follow your bliss, be just crazily in love with it, and it will blossom on its own. In your language, be so passionate like you are for your girlfriend or your boyfriend. For your business, and you'll automatically flourish. For I guarantee you that. Thank you.
All right. Thank you all. So I guess we have gathered enough motivation to again think about starting our startups soon. So now coming on to strategies, the safest place to hide in this world is the second page of Google search. This is the era of disruptive innovation, which demands that you need not be hide only of your own game, but also of others' game as well. So this is where business strategies of growth come into picture. Now coming on to Ankit sir, you have been a disruptive innovator and you also have had the first mover advantage in renewable energy sector. I would like to ask how you keep yourself a step ahead of your competitors all the time.
Amit, actually it's a very rightly asked question, because we definitely had a first mover advantage when we moved in 2011 into the solar industry. When we commissioned our first megawatt, in September 2011 we started the business, and in September 2012 we commissioned the first megawatt. That time the total installation across India was 3 megawatt. I'm saying across India. I mean, one was in Punjab and the other 2 megawatt was in other state. That gave us a first mover advantage. We came up with a very innovative concept of turnkey solutions, wherein the project we'll be putting up for megawatt scale plus, and then you know we'll be selling the power to open access customers within Maharashtra. But with first mover, there are certain disadvantages also, because for the first project, we have to take around 178 permissions from 18 various departments of Maharashtra government. So the mantra which I would like to share with you all is that first mover will give you advantage, but you have to be very courageous to deal with the problems, because in business, you are going to face at least 100 problems a day. Just make them and analyze them, whether it's a short-term problem, long-term problem, or a medium-term problem. And then try to address that. Normally what happens, that a problem comes and we disturb our entire day. We don't try and analyze it. So we all should analyze that. And as Enrich, when we moved into the market, it gave us first mover advantage, because ours is the only solar park in India right now where the private PPAs are being signed by the state government right now till date. So it's definitely a first mover advantage for us.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now. Nand Kishore sir, your business is primarily into a Me Too business category, where there are already established firms which are into selling of desi ghee and all. So in this era or in this heightened competition, how do you develop your points of differentiation or the unique selling points, which we call, to sustain your business?
See, for example, our flagship product is ghee. Ghee is ghee. What we took when we launched our ghee product as a tagline is, which age-old theory of ghee should be danedar. So people forget that, and in current scenario, all these doctors and they say not to eat ghee, but there is a misconception that ghee and vegetable fat. So age-old, if you go to Ayurveda, we took a punchline from Ayurveda that aroma, taste should be intact. So when we launched our ghee, we made a punchline that ekdam shuddh or danedar. So which has given a lot of advantage to us when in placement, because people realized, the senior citizens at our home, they realized that ghee should be, how the quality of ghee should be and all. That we communicated well. So, and there is a lot of space for good quality product. There is absolutely, I believe there is no competition for good quality products. There are many, many brands which are available. Still, there is a space for new brands to come up, in particularly in our space. And if you take anything, whatever you, in solar energy, wind energy, there are so many, they have covered Maharashtra, entire India is open, world is open for their. So if you are doing a good work, good quality, then absolutely need not worry about competition. Like Barkha said, ke product quality will speak about the sales growth, not only the product design and the branding. Of course, it plays an important role, but not the only criteria to make things happen. That's what I feel about launching new products. Believe in your quality, believe in your product, and give the best possible service to your customers. That is what I feel.
Thank you, sir. So it is. So these are the basic QSPs, quality, service, and price, which play a role of key differentiators when you are in a me-too business category. Now, Vishal, sir, you are primarily into sales as well as services, and that too of a BMW, which itself is a very luxurious car. So in this competition, or in this era where people are, customers are demanding, they are spoiled for choices. So how do you adopt strategies?
Our most important strategy here is, I believe, especially for the service sector, you can sell a product once, but if you can't take care of it, then you've lost 10 more customers coming with him, and they repeat buyers. So our focus is only service. The product design and substance are decided and already established. So for us, product is already taken for granted. They are not to be discussed. But service is something which is in our hand. As long as you can take care of your customer, I think you're home. What we also forget is, acquiring new customers is the most important part of business, but taking care of the old one is something which we forget. We take them for granted, and we don't do that. So that's the most important aspect we follow.
Rightly said, sir. And one more thing which I would like to highlight is that losing a customer pays a lot. And academic research have already proven that getting a new customer, it requires 10 times more funding, manpower, and resources than engaging a customer who's already there with you. So it is quite logical to keep your already engaged customer happy and satisfied than for pitching for others who are already unsatisfied. So Barkha ma'am, you have also been into this disruptive innovation category. Now once this this sector would flourish, you would see other competitors pitching in as well. So do you make strategies to overcome that competition upfront?
I think I just believe in giving 100% in the now and just focusing on, today. Just today, whatever customers I have, today what is my duty to be done to fulfill each and every customer, that's what I do. And just go with the flow and just each day live 100% is what I believe in. Yeah.
All right. So now coming on to change. As you all know, that change is the only permanent thing. Nature is changing, markets are changing, human needs are changing. New technologies are appearing and old technologies are disappearing. Now some seek stability, certainty, and predictability, the status quo, while others seek change in their status. With stability comes peace, monotony, and stagnation, while with change comes stress, excitement, and growth. So this change, sometimes it is from within and sometimes it is not in our hands. The government policies or the macroeconomic factors come into picture. So we'll begin with Barkha ma'am, that how do these changes affect your business and what would you advise the young budding entrepreneurs that how do they take change as opportunities?
Changes?
Change as opportunities. The hurdles which they are coming in the business, how do they convert it into opportunities?
I think that, you know, there is no I think there's no rule book as such wherein, you know, it's like a straight road with a definite destination that you'll get in your career or in your business, you know. It's going to be sometimes speed breaker rahega, sometimes there's going to be koi khadda rahega. It's going to be like that, you know. So you have to speed breaker rahega, so you have to drive your car a little slow and then leap on it. If there's a bump there, you just take a turn. So I think as and when whatever in each of your industry that you will face, you just need to tackle with each of it with full sincerity. Like a lot of times it happens in my case also, you know, competitors do try to sabotage my name. They do try to do things, you know, that unnecessarily they'll try to malign my designs and say that things which they purposely do, whereas, but I am so confident about my design, about my work, that even my customers that just don't bother about those people who try to just, you know, bad mouth about me or something. It happens. It's business, you know. Everybody's going to, as you grow, you're going to face all these things. So I think to be confident about yourself is most important, and then face each and every situation as and when it comes with full sincerity and passion, I think. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Like they say, a startup comes up with three C's: conviction, confidence, and competency. So, Vishal sir, I would like to cite the example of Volkswagen, which recently faced technical glitches due to which the whole dealership network faced a lot of pinch. So this was something which was not in the hands of the dealers, the crisis which the company went through. So in these crisis situation, how do you respond to this change?
Like Barkha said, people forgive and forget as long as you can love them back. You can connect them back. So how you respond back in this crisis situation is very important. And one thing I would like to say is, you know, either we can be penny-wise, pound-foolish, or just keep investing, you know. Money will definitely come, but as long as you can, today you can say a thing I can't sell because it's in loss. I mean, I would say just sell it, you know. Just sell it and then let's see later. You can earn money later. But at this moment, you know, respond to the customer, give your 100% and more. And because your future depends on that. It's not short term. So as long as you can respond back with love and respond back rightly and be there, you can easily shut your shop and run away and say, I don't want to answer anyone. But if you're there, people will ask you questions, barge you with it. But I think you will be a winner out of that. That would be the approach I would take.
Okay, thank you, sir. Now, Nand Kishore, sir. Now, since the world is becoming a globalized village, even there has been huge transformation in the eating habits of Indians. We have recently seen they have been consuming pastas and pizzas and so many items to tell upon. Now, this change has not been something which has been gradual since independence. It has been later stages of 2000, it has been more evident or more prevalent. So in this era of cheese and butters and those things, how do you uphold the power of desi ghee?
See, it's a product which has evolved over ages. So now you see in the era of cheese and butter, there's big name coming up. Everybody is talking about that brand, Patanjali and all. So we, as long as we are in India, the theory, Ayurveda theory and all, we need not worry about our product. I will not say specifically about ghee, because it's a generic product. It will be consumed throughout India in so many ways, direct eating, in sweets. There are so many ways to consume ghee. So as long as you are confident about your product, that it's a future product and it is not going, I'll tell you my example. I was into computer stationery business when I was in Pune. So that was continuous stationery business. Over a period of time, slowly, I felt that this is a dying industry because of emails, inkjet printers, and so many changes happening in the system. So I thought this business would not be there for a longer period of time. That time when I thought of it, I wanted to be into the business which has no death. For every business, there is a change of cycle. Like you see the film rolls, the industry Kodak, and those companies have almost has to change the business or shut down their businesses. So at the passage of time, you have to change yourself, your strategies, and all those things. Right now, we don't see any dearth or difficulty that over a period there would be people who will not be consuming ghee or milk products. Milk product industry, it's a growing industry. हम तो बोलते हैं बाकी सब लोग अपना काम धंधा शुरू करने के पहले हम हमारा कमाई करके सो जाते हैं. सुबह 7 बजे तक दूध डिलीवरी हो जाता है सब लोग. आप लोग आँख खोलते हैं तो हमारा बिजनेस खत्म हो चुका होता है. सो यू हैव टू हैव बिलीव. You have to have faith in yourself, like Barkha says, ki as you love your girlfriend or boyfriend, but aajkal sunte hain ki kuch saal baad mein bore bhi ho jate. You should not get bored. You should love your business as your wife. You should not get bored and divorced. So that's what I feel. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Now, coming on to Ankit, sir. Now, we have seen that the government plans to have complete electrification of the nation by 2019. So it is coming up with renewable energy sources as a sector to look upon, and it is also making policies so that more people enter into this. So this is something, this change is actually is going to be beneficial for you as a startup or as a firm. So how do you respond to changes which are actually beneficial to you? So how do you adopt strategies to implement those?
Well, Amit, first thing is, we are actually into a non-conventional business. So our business is very different. And we are into a business which is totally policy-driven and technology-driven. Policy is getting evaluating day by day. There are a lot of changes, whether in the state or into the center. And similarly, the technologies, whether in India or across the world. So we, as a company, always have to focus on innovating. The only way you can respond to change is innovation. Like I said, when we did the prototyping in 2011, in 2012 September, all of a sudden there was a big change in the policy in Maharashtra, which forced us, there was only two decisions, either whatever huge infrastructure investment we had made on the land, on the power evacuation facilities, electrical facilities and all, we either shut it off and sell it off, or there was that we come up with some kind of innovation where we are able to go and convince our customer that this, because we are into a project sales, right? So we need to convince them this project sales is still a better choice of investment for them. So we, I remember it happened in November 2012 and somewhere in December we did, came up with a new kind of power cell solution. And luckily in March 2013, we did around 12 megawatt, which was somewhere around 150 crores of turnover that year. Since that day and this day, every year the policy is changing for us. We did first year in Maharashtra, second year we did in Telangana. This year we are doing major business in Karnataka. Next year we'll be doing major business in Andhra Pradesh. So you know, you have to keep evolving with the time. And now with this, coming to a question, with this new government coming in, there is a lot of hope on this renewable energy sector. In fact, I will tell you that most of, if you are willing and if you are most of the budding entrepreneur, there is a lot of training sessions being done by various institutions like Solar Energy Corporation of India. They are giving full page ads in the Times of India and all, and they are giving training how to do a business into the renewable energy sector. So as a company, we are not only focusing now into solar. Solar is definitely will be our core business. We have started our venture into geothermal. We have done a tie-up with the center for tidal also. And very soon we'll be coming up with the wave. So these are certain, you know, certain innovation, as I told you, is our key. So we are keep focusing on renewables so that we can be aligned with the central government mission.
Okay. Great, sir. So an entrepreneur need not be only retrospective, but he also needs to be prospective. How, changes are happening and how does he respond to changes. And the most important point is the speed in which he responds to. Because just remember that in today's era, it's not the big which eats the small, it's the fast which eats the slow. So this is something which a pearl of wisdom, which I guess you would be interested in noting down. Now, giving a different perspective to this discussion, borrowing an analogy from Dr. Devdatta Patnaik, business is akin to performing a yajna. The owner is the yajman who performs the yajna and customer is the devta. Yajman puts offering in the fire or agni, exclaiming swaha, and chanting mantras with the hope of pleasing his devta and who would bless him with tathastu. The agni is the medium for owners of the business to engage with the customers. This brings me to the next question on customer engagement and managing customer relationships. Now, I would like to ask Nandkishore sir, your mantra on customer engagement and managing customer relationship from, because you are mostly in a into handling dealers and networks. So how do you manage these relationships?
We are in the category of FMCG segment. Any small mistake, as you have seen in the case of Maggie or Cadbury, it pays a lot to our type of companies. So ultimate our aim and goal is that end user, that is consumer, should be satisfied and whatever complaints, there would be complaints. No, we cannot, nobody can satisfy all the customers at to the level of 100%. Even in Cadbury or Maggie, there would be some sort of defects. So if we don't address their grievances properly and in time, it will escalate to the next level. And in the food product business, it's mouth publicity, of course, like in the first slide, Barkha said, ki look-wise we can sell it once, but if the quality is not good, whatsoever may be the case, whether low price, good attractive, we cannot sell. So if customer is complaining, you don't think it is not a genuine complaint. Whatever customer complains, it's a genuine complaint. That's what we adopt as a policy. If we research it at our end, if it is not, we go back to that customer, we say probably it must have happened with you, but we'll try to rectify it rather than saying no, we have checked it and everything is fine with our quality. Customer will never accept. We'll have to get back to our roots and communicate to customers that yes, we have taken you, we have noted your complaints. So only that faith and feel that yeah, the brand is listening to me, they are not ignoring me. Ignorance of customer will be the biggest drawback for drawback in growth of any company. That's what I feel regarding customer satisfaction. That is utmost important. Mahatma Gandhi kabhi business nahi kiya, but wo bhi bolte the grahak mera devta hai. So we should understand that policy.
Absolutely. And responding to a customer's query is, I guess, the most important thing. And that was the most important takeaway from the Maggie crisis, which we have learned up till now. Now, Ankit sir, your interaction is not with the end users, but it is with the subsidiaries who are in between, whether they are governmental organizations or some other firms. So the relation or the way of interacting would be different. Could you please throw some light on that?
Well, our relation is mostly B2B, so we don't directly interact with because the projects which we put up, the power is getting consumed mostly by the government organizations, the state electricity board. So, but the investment is made by the high net worth individuals or the corporates. And we, you know, kind of get married for 25 years at the beginning itself. So our relation, because we have to maintain their plan for 25 years. So we have to keep our relation alive for 25 years. So even in marriage, if you get bored, you need to do some kind of other, things to make the relationship happening. So same thing applies with us. We have to ensure that they are getting their investment on return, which we have promised timely. It's a policy-driven business. A lot of time problems come, but we make them sure that we are keeping a transparency with them so that they understand the problem See, as it is rightly said that customers in India, you can't fool them up. You have to be transparent with them. If they know what is the matter, they will also come up and give up you some solutions, or they will at least understand your problem. So we always try to keep that transparency with our end customers.
Okay, all right, thank you, sir. Now taking our analogy of the yajna a little further, now Hindu mythology has 33 crore gods and goddesses. The yajman, depending on which devta he is trying to please, customizes his ritual and mantras to suit that devta. Now, Barkha ma'am, you would know this fact very nicely because you have been interacting with different customers and each has his own perception about his own startup. So how do you deal? How do you modify your strategies to engage with him?
Can you elaborate?
All right, so the thing is that nowadays every customer would has his or her perception towards particularly to your sector, that he has his own vision about his startup, his own perception about his venture or his firm which he's dealing with. So he would have different expectations or different ideas about it. So how do you deal with, how do you manage to make sure that even your ideas are fulfilled and even their expectations are not dissatisfied?
We deal with each of them, like as I just answered before, it's somewhat the similar kind that, you know, it's not a fixed road with a definite destination. For each customer, we have a different way of dealing with it. And it's a very deep answer to give because subject to subject, to each its own, how we deal depends on person to person. Like, you know, some customers, like there was a concept of Vastu-based logo. So we have to make that logo. There was in between the demand for a numerological logo. We might design a numerology kaise dalu. So there is sometimes these issues do come to us, but then we make the customer understand. You know, sometimes they get off track of the main reason for designing the logo, and they get into the other details which is not required. So we, I don't give up and just do it because he's saying a lal color dalo to lal good hai. I want lal because my sister-in-law wants lal color, so you put it. We don't do all that. We make them understand why and what a perception of a color is, or a font, or a design is, or a shape is, and then according to that, we give them different, and make them understand psychologically what are the effects, and then convince them. Yeah.
All right. Thank you, ma'am. Now, Vishal sir, you have a dealership of the elite class BMW as well as Maruti Suzuki. Now, both of them have a different set of customers and both of them cater to a different category of customers. Now, the shopping trends or the shopping behavior, consumer buying behavior in both the sectors is entirely different. Both the customers has their different set of expectations, different set of service requirements, and different set of mode of communications. So how do you manage to handle both of them, or how do you differentiate the strategies in handling customers from Maruti Suzuki and handling customers from BMW?
One is the basic principles of every handling the customer doesn't change, irrespective of what class you're buying. So it means that you cannot ignore a person who's buying a Maruti and only take care of the person who's buying a BMW. So basic principles have to be same, and basically a customer has to be heard. And if you go in a defensive mode, like Nand Kishore ji said, that if he says this is wrong, and if you're just saying you are an idiot, no, this is can't be wrong. So that's where you start your decline. So basic principles of handling customers same. Now how you handle depends on the quality of people you employ and quality of service you give. So there has to be differentiation, but the principle has to be same. So you can't treat a BMW customer like a Maruti. He has to have a premium experience. For that you make premium place, premium, you employ people with better experience, you pay them more, and handle the customer in a more premium way. But principles has to be same. So that's the difference.
All right, providing premium customer service is applicable to both the segments, but understanding their needs upfront and responding accordingly is the key mantra. Now, moving on to the last question of this panel discussion, and then we'll have a rapid fire, and then we'll open the panel for the audience. Now, I would like to quote Carlton Fisk, who says that it's not what you achieve, it's what you overcome. That's what defines your career. An entrepreneur's journey is never complete without failures. I would like to ask this question to each of the panelists: how often you encounter failures and how do you overcome them? Begin with, anyways, who would like to voluntarily take this?
Failure or decline in business is something which throws you back to the drawing board. And more than failure, if your business is declining, I think it's the best time to reinvest in the business. That's the time you can invest in the business, go back to your basics, invest again in infrastructure, and be ready for the new challenges. And either in a failure, you can shut down the business, go home, and be jobless, or say study what is wrong and easier to come back, because you've just learned the lesson, the most expensive lesson of your life. If you failed by investing money and you opened a business and you just failed in it, you just learned the most expensive lesson of your life. Either you can waste it or you can learn and grow back much more powerful. I think no one can be more powerful than you when you fail on that topic, because you've just learned how not to do things. And others are going to still learn after doing their own mistakes, but you've just done it. So yeah, to me it's the biggest opportunity to come.
For me, failure, I wouldn't use the word failure at all. Firstly, I use it as the learning curve. It is just a learning curve. It just teaches you something. And if you are failing, it really means that God is giving you some opportunity to
discover something in you which is going to help you flourish in the future. And I had seen an interview of Mr. Shah Rukh Khan wherein he had said that, you know, jab hum initially fail hote hai, that is a very good sign that you are, forming a foundation. So don't get scared when you initially fail, and you should fail, because then is when you will start succeeding. It's just learning. It's just a learning curve.
Absolutely. And I would like to quote what Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam says: fail means first attempt in learning. So Nand Kishore sir, would like to have your views.
There cannot be a success without failure in anybody's life. If you take example, any big entrepreneur, they have failed in their businesses. There is one story I'll tell you, a small story about Nana Patekar. So when the movie Ankush was launched, next day morning, everybody was interviewing him and saying, "Arre, aap to raato raat hero ban gaye." So Nana Patekar just said one line. "Haan, aapki baat to sahi hai ki main raato raat hero ban gaya. Wo raat kitni lambi thi, wo sirf mujhe pata hai." So he was struggling a lot. So when you are on a success path, people will see only your success. I would, as a budding entrepreneur, I would advise not to take the path which other people have taken for success, but understand where they have failed and what they did to rectify that failure. That will give you strength and energy to make a strategy, business plan, everything. Suppose if in a FMCG sector, like a recent example of Maggi, whatever happened with Maggi, and if we continue carelessly, if we continue to sell our products carelessly without taking the cognizance of what happened with Maggi, we may also fail. We should understand from the difficulties of others, also our own difficulties, but as well as others' difficulties. That's a very good thing. There are so many books about success mantra, how do we success, but if you Google it, you will get many more things. Why take the case of Air Deccan, where it has gone wrong, so that the next time when anybody entering into the same segment or same strategy, they will try to avoid those mistakes. So that's what I would tell you. Learn from the mistakes of others as well as your own.
Yes.
An intelligent entrepreneur is the one who learns, unlearns, and then relearns. So we'll have Ankit sir's views on this.
I'll share a small story which I believe some of you might have heard. Warren Buffett was having a second line person who grew his investment around 1,000 times in a decade's time. And one of his decision went very wrong, and he lost worth of around $2 billion and something. So next day, everybody was thinking in the office that now Warren Buffett will sack that person off and he will not keep him in job. But next day, what Warren Buffett did was that he promoted him and make him the head of that division. So everybody was curious why he did that. So he said that he has learned at my cost. His failure was at my cost. Why this cost should be enjoyed by someone else? So he promoted him and made him learn. So we don't have to be worried about failures. Failures will come. It is not necessary a failure means a failure in the business. Whatever strategy you are planning, sometimes that can get failed. Suppose you have done a positioning of your product at a marketplace and that went wrong. So that might be a failure. But you should keep learning from your failures. And since it's the last question, I'd just like to share two more things. Don't be, you know, in haste while you're into the business. A lot of us, you know, just try to see that we are going into business because we have to be multimillionaire overnight. So that's a very misconception. You are going into business because that's your choice. You wanted to do something as an entrepreneur. You don't want to do as a job. So just correct this conception, because every business, it is very rightly said, that takes at least 1,000 days to get established. So you should have that patience for 1,000 days. And second thing is, just keep PCO in your mind. I personally follow this. One of my marketing professors have teach us this, that there are three principles in life which you should follow, and you will never get failed, whether at society, whether at business, or whether at some else place. First is planning. Second is communication, and third one is ownership. If you misplan, you fail. If you miscommunicate, you fail. And if you don't own the ownership, you fail. So if you see all the problems across the world, or at your home, or at anywhere else, these will be the most three reasons. So I will share that you all try and be the best at the PCO and be patient when you start your own
business.
Absolutely. Being patient is a very important aspect, because many successful entrepreneurs say that do business with emotions, but don't get emotional. So engineering students from University of Pune are sitting over here, and they would agree with me that even if you, in your examinations, even if you score in 30s, you're moved on to 40 and you're marked as pass. So, but yeah, that's a good move actually. I don't have any offense to that. But on a whole, we can say that our education system, right from KG to PG, trains us to avoid failures. Whereas entrepreneurship, ironically, is all about facing failures. So this is a whole paradigm shift which mentally you have to change, so that you accept entrepreneurship and accept failures upfront.
Amit, I'll just interrupt you here.
Yeah.
Actually, if you see, this has happened post-independence. And this was, I mean, most of us don't realize, we have been put into that kind of education system by Britishers. Earlier, India was not like that. And that's the reason you were just quoting sometime back that 250 years, we are doing a lot of, you know, the GDP was somewhere 33%. So that was the reason original education system was teaching us these kind of things, wherein you don't have to learn just from passing from HKG to first to second, come to 12th, choose a business, do MBA. So you can do whatever you want. That was the old education system we were having.
So now we all
as an individual have to take this change ahead.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Thanks a lot. And now moving on to the rapid fire round. I hope it creates some excitement and it ends the panel discussion on a very high note. All right, I'll begin with, I hope all the panelists are ready. I'll begin with Barkha ma'am. So keep your mic ready so that we can get an instinct reply from your side. If I give you a time machine, would you prefer to travel in the past or in the future?
I would like to stop the time machine in the now and just keep living in the now, because even the past is now and the future is now. Now is the time.
That's a very good answer from ma'am. That's really commands an applause. Okay. Now I would like to ask Nand Kishore sir, In crisis, you follow your instinct or follow the data available. Or let me put it in a different manner, you follow your head or your heart?
Both.
Okay.
In business, heart will only following heart will never is a good solution, give you good solutions. You have to have heart and brain together, put it together, only then you will have proper solutions to the crisis.
Great, sir. Now, Vishal sir, what is important to you, profitability or brand value?
Brand value.
Great. Could you elaborate?
Brand stays longer, profit might extinct someday.
That's an important pearl of wisdom coming your way, entrepreneurs. And last but not least, sir, I would like, now this question is related to a piece of advice which the aspiring entrepreneurs would like to know. What are your views on starting young and raw or getting some experience and then starting as an entrepreneur?
See, I'll share it from my personal experience. I'll go with the choice B. Reason being that when you, it goes back to our education system. See, when we are in engineering, you're not, your college is doing a lot of things right now here so that they are learning organization culture, but this is not the same system across India. So the budding entrepreneur, they are just shifted from education and on the job field. There is a hell lot of difference between the both. So at least you should have experience of 2-3 years or 4 years where you can understand the industry culture. You know the basics of doing the business. You know what are the basic things which needs to be targeted. And then you switch on to a business. That's what I personally believe because I've done it that way and I feel that's the right way to do it.
All right. This question we'd like to extend to other panelists as well if they want to give their views on it.
As far as I'm concerned, I started, we Indians are born businessmen. And jugaad is something which is in our blood. We should never let that go. I started in my 11th standard. I was a commerce student, 20% in college, 80% had business. I couldn't sit there because the instinct to do business and earn my own money was something which was calling me. So if you can do a part-time and save your time, I sometimes see people starting their business at 40. I said, boss, this is the time to enjoy life, not start earning money. So if you can start already doing some part-time job, because every day, I personally feel in college MBA is not as effective as on-field MBA, You have to learn your own, you have to pay your dues. And shortcuts are very easy. We heard a lot of stories. Even I get frustrated. Yeah, this guy made millions in today. But it's only 1%, and we don't hear their bad stories. So we all have to pay our dues, and that is the on-field dues. Please start early. That's my recommendation.
All right, sir. Growth happens when we make the journey from being dependent to being dependable. This happens when we focus on who we are rather than what we have. On this very note, I'd like to sum up the panel discussion. I would like to thank all the panelists for joining in. Now, we would like to open the panel discussion for the audience question and answer session. We can have 3 questions as of now. So, volunteers, please coordinate. Just a request before you ask a question, kindly introduce yourself and what education are you pursuing right now, and then the person whom you are intending to ask the question.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Prathamesh More. I am a third year mechanical student. My question was for first movers, one of the hurdle would be that what should be the price of the product because we don't have anything to compare it with. Okay, so if the product is cheap, our profit margins go down, and also for the consumer's perception, if the product is available for cheap, it is not been valued. But if we increase its cost or make it costly, the competitors may sell it for cheaper rates. So how do you determine the perfect value of it? So that's what my question is.
I'll take on this.
Yeah, sure.
What's your name, you told?
My name is Prathamesh.
Prathamesh, before going to the market, it's very important that you decide your strategy. And to decide the strategy, there is a first basic need of doing the STP analysis. Segmentation, targeting and positioning. Now, you said that the product is cheap. No product in the world is cheap. You have a consumer for every product. Vada pav khane wale bhi log hai, five star mein jaake khane wale bhi log hai, right? So no product is cheap. You have to define what positioning of your product you want to do, where you want to segment it off, and how you want to target your audience. So once you do that, you will get your answer that where I have to keep the product cost. Because I'll give you an example. In switch industry, you have heard about Legrand, right? Anchor and all. So Anchor is a switch which is amongst the middle segment. But if you go into the higher end switches like Legrand's, there is a premium range. They are very high. If you talk about the cost is more or less same, hardly 10% difference on the cost here and there. But if you talk about the price is 300% time difference. So it's not about the cost, it's about the positioning of the product which you want to do at the marketplace.
Surfing the market is more important. About whom are we going to sell the products?
Definitely. You have to position your product where you want to do it.
Okay, so thank you very much.
Good morning, I'm Kunal Ganorkar. I'm from Modern College of Engineering. Sir, this is for Ankit Kanchal, sir. And so you mentioned you're from the B2B section of the society. And we also have an idea in the B2B. So could you, you know, give us some insight into the branding and marketing for B2B? Because so far we've covered B2C, I think, since yesterday.
What kind of concept you are into?
We are into home automation.
Yeah, so I was just talking about the switch industry.
Exactly.
So you are into B2C right now?
No. We spoke about B2C yesterday, I think. So I thought if you could cover a little about B2B.
See, in automation industry right now, the market trend is more on B2C market. If you talk about B2B, you have to do a institutional sales,
yeah,
which few of the companies are doing right now. But the market share which they are having right now is very, very minimal. So being a startup, you should try and see that you go with the industry line, which is right now B2C, because that's the automation, that's how the automation world is going right now. Later on, once your product is established into the customer B2C market, then you can focus to shift your customer from B2B. There are many companies which have done the same way. They earlier positioned themselves into the B2C, then they came up with a different name of range and they started focusing into B2B. So they have both the products. One is into B2C, another one is into B2B.
Okay. So you would suggest that I start up with B2C and then go into
that
B2B.
Will be more safest bet, I will
okay.
say.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Next.
I would like to just extend this this question. See, B2B and B2C, for depending on your business, you are if you are into like he said B2B business, the other B could be C also. So it is always B2C. But it is the banking parameters or B2C, it is not that you should reach the end consumer. Like in his industry, the end consumer is the person who invests in solar energy. He generates energy for himself, right? So he is using, right? And he may be selling the excess energy which he is generating. So he is the consumer for him. So C stands for consumer. Yeah. So always consider your clients as C only, not B. Probably when he starts selling these energy in the open market for household, government does not permit that. But when it starts, then it becomes B2C. Still, I would say Ankitji is also into B2C business, but his customers are institutional big customers. Right, we sell a lot of bulk product to organizations like Amul or Britannia or Patanjali. In our business community, we call it a B2B business. But of course, they are also customers to us. Understand? C stands for customer. Okay, so always. It depends what Ankit ji rightly said. It depends on your strategy and type of product. What type of product you want to be into, what type of business and product, and the strategy. If your product, like in our business, we can sell ghee in bulk tankers to organizations like Tirupati Devasthan, they consume a lot of ghee for making laddu. That is B2B business for us. It does not create a brand value for us. Because what does not create brand value is B2B business. What creates brand value for you is B2C business. That differentiation, we sell butter in 20 kg packs. It is used by small ghee makers or bakery people. So they may come up with, no, Shubhi butter will give us more realization, better quality for their product. It is raw material for their, butter is raw material for their. But for us, he is a consumer. So if he insists that I need Shubhi butter for manufacturing of bakery products, then he is a B2C customer for me. So anything which is sold in brand is called B2C. Anything which is sold unbranded is B2B business. Please understand this. He may, Suzlon. Suzlon windmills are B2C business. Suzlon is a brand. Likewise, Ankitji's brand would be a B2C business. So strategize properly and then continue.
Good morning. My question is for Bakha, ma'am. My name is Aishwarya Upadhyay. Ma'am, businesses are run with the help of teams, and your business is into 9 different cities. And you are the only face, means a face person of your brand. Like your brand is your name only. So how do you deal with your customers? Because a person may come from Hyderabad, at the same time it may come from Pune, and they want you only to design it. How do you deal with those situations?
Nine offices, we have a team, management team there to handle those customers. But designing only and only happens from my head office where I sit. Every design, how much ever customers are there, each and every design goes through me. There is no logo or no kind of designing that I don't supervise. Each and everything I have to see, I approve, and only then it goes to the customer. So it's from Bombay, we email, you know, to Hyderabad or kahin bhi ho, we email them.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
This will be the last question, then we'll wind up. Last question, sorry.
My question is also for Bakha, ma'am. My name is Aditya Agnihotri. I am from VIT College.
Mechanical department. Ma'am, you appear to do a lot of research and deep analysis for your clients, the logos which you make. Has it happened sometimes that people do not perceive the things in the way you appear? Because you gave examples about the logos made for Madhavan Amir Khan and that Gujarati newspaper.
Janmabhoomi.
Yeah. They may not appeal. So they may not be so appealing to few common people. Like, so how do you deal at that time? Has it happened that you faced failure?
See, what happens is sometimes my logo is even not understood and liked by my own customer that I'm selling to.
If I'm giving my logo, okay, I have done my research work. We make them fill a questionnaire wherein we ask them your color preference and your target audience. And we ask them a lot of questions. We have a nice questionnaire made. That questionnaire goes to my research team. The client must have said that, you know, I want a red, blue, and green color. But my research says that black, blue, black, orange, and pink color is what suits their brand. Okay, so then I will make the logos according to what my research team says and not to please him. Because my duty is not to please my customer, but my duty is to please his customer, which is increase his sale. So we don't compromise on brands because I think it is very, very important for, we have to convince them, you know, I don't sell logo if they don't understand it. You know, I mean, they have to take the logo based on, I take them to the research office, I make them understand that why we are doing this. And it's nothing about your personal choice that we are looking into, and I'm not here to please you as a customer, but I'm here to please your sales figure. So they understand, and that's why we are in this position, because we don't believe in compromising or kehten kisi ko maska nahi marna hai. We have to see to it that we are helping them in their brand development, because we are not doing something which is a joke, which is very, very important, because it's the face of the brand, and at least for next 25 years, it's going to be on the face of that brand. So it has to be taken very seriously. So whether he likes it or not likes it, he has to take it.
All right.
I would like to add a last thing. before summing up this panel discussion. See, most of the people, ideation, yesterday the session has come up, I was not here, but how do you get an idea? That's the most important part, because you, when you start walking, only then you'll reach somewhere, wherever you wish to decide. There may be hurdles, so many things, and in course of time, you may have to change the direction of your walk and all those things. But what I feel is, I also learn from what I read in newspapers and success stories, failure stories, and all those things. So there are so many problems across. So there is nothing that which is not there in this world. Everything is there. But I'll give you an example of, you must have heard about Red Bus. And you know the story behind Red Bus? The gentleman who started the Red Bus, he wanted to travel from Bangalore to Hyderabad during Deepavali festival. So, but due to his busy schedule and all those things, he could not book the bus tickets. And later on, when he went there, he found that the tickets rates were like flight tickets. From normally, it would have been 500, 600. But that day, people were quoting 3,000, 4,000. So he realized it has happened with me. It could have happened with so many people. So he started bus ticket booking app. And you know, thereafter, what has happened to Red Bus? Sequoia acquired that Red Bus for 750 crores, right? So the problem with that gentleman faced gave him an idea. So there are so many things, so many problems in our society or commission, like Ola taxi app. We are facing a lot of difficulties for finding taxi during night, day. When we travel, we get cheated by rickshawwalas, taxi walas. We don't reach to our place on time because of their small this thing. So you will find an idea. You see where is the biggest problem rise and try to find a solution for that problem. It could give you a very, very big opportunity to grow. Whatever I have seen, the recent startups, they have grown because of their innovation idea, which were disruptive. Flipkart started with selling books, I believe, right? Now they are into everything. No matter, funding is available. I meet so many investors across in Mumbai. So much of funds are available. Recent case of housing.com, their revenues were 1.48 crores, 1.5 crores revenue. Company valued at 1500 crores because of idea. It's a very good business, house brokering business. So idea would give you a lot of funding, but the idea should be scalable. Not only idea, it should be scalable. Only you will get required help from all the sections, funding and everything, whatever you need for your entrepreneur journey. Thank you.
Okay, one last question from my side. I take the privilege of the last question.
Sure, sir.
Vishal, luxury brand marketing. Now, when I see a Maruti Thar ad on TV, I see a Hyundai ad Thar on TV, I see a Titan watch ad on TV, I don't see a BMW ad. I don't see a Rolex ad. How do you market luxury brands? And whereas, when you go into a Louis Vuitton shop, you have to stand in a line to purchase. How do you market a luxury brand? How different do you market a luxury brand than a brand which is selling products to the middle class or the upper middle class?
The biggest difference comes in the brand positioning. If you see all the brands which have stopped marketing, have invested in themselves so much, and they've created a snob value. Now, why we stand outside a Louis Vuitton shop and we are not ready to stand outside any other shop? Why? I mean, it's because in spite of giving zero discount, the manufacturing cost of a Louis Vuitton bag is 2,300 or 400 rupees, which they sell at approximately minimum a lakh to upwards. Huh? So, and we still want to pay that. It's the brand perception which they've created. And I mean, aren't there competitions? There are. You can get bags for $2,000, for $500. But why that bag? I mean, it's the brand perception which people have created. And it's your choice whether you want to deal with masses or to the elite. When you're dealing with the elite, then you stop marketing, because then one elite will speak to another. See, I got this watch. How's it? He says, wow, I like it. Then he himself goes back to that shop, stand in queue, wait for the guy to approach, get treated. Of course, you have to give the best experience then. You can't kick the customer out. And it's all backed up by the right customer experience, right brand perception, right product has to be the best. And then in the package of all, you become the most successful brand. Well, that's why they don't need marketing, because their customers are marketing for themselves. It's not newspaper, it's not a TV, but the owner whom they have sold is the live seller. I mean, they made the seller pay for their product, use it, stand in line first, pay for the product, take it with zero discount. And that guy is also, they've employed him as a salesman. He's going and telling other, you want this, you want this, you want this. And he's not even getting paid for it. So that's the power of the brand which has come up, you know. And that's what, anything is possible. Anything is possible, for sure. We heard this acquiring stories from startups. I mean, and like a right idea can, backed by scalability, like what Atulji said, it could take you to the best company in India today. As long as you can, if your product can deal for problems of people, you are the most successful. If there is a problem, if you have a problem, you have a problem to book a bus ticket, you have a problem to buy a flight ticket, you treat that, you're the most successful. Want, first is to treat the want of a customer, then you'll be successful for sure. But if you can treat the problem of a customer, you just can't fail. I mean, you're treating what someone has an issue. And it could be anything. Today, I mean, it's growing. Rail tickets is also growing on app. You know, one or two apps are dealing, it's growing day by day. There is a problem, you have to pay under the table to get a right train ticket. If the app solves it, you're not doing anything. Taxi was the biggest issue. This was a problem. You solve it, you see Uber where it is today. It's the most valued company without any asset. Uber has zero assets and the most valued company in the world today. What did they do? They dealt with the problem of people. I mean, it's simple. If you can, first is associate with the wants, and next step is if you can choose the problem and create a brand which no one else can challenge. You know, all three can take you places. Bharat, I hope I've answered your question.
Good afternoon. Myself, Saurabh Setia, engineering student. Wish and dream to be an entrepreneur. And my question is for everybody. And I expect that all should give me my answer from heart, because the question demands that. It goes like out of my curiosity. It's like what the worst thing can happen to an entrepreneur, and what for what he should be prepared, and what best things he should hope for. According to your experience and your perspective, I would like to listen.
The worst thing is death. Only one word answer to your question is death.
No, sir. Emotionally, sir, I ask you from your heart, because when we are like defeated terribly, only emotions can.
You have to have the courage to bounce back. Everywhere, nobody from outside will come and tell you, "Acha, tum fail ho gaye, koi baat nahi." In the society we live in, if you are a failure, in India, failure is not accepted. Whereas if you go to US, everywhere, they consider failure as a, there's something he did, so he failed.
But if you don't try to do anything, you will never fail in your life. Don't do anything. So you have to take chances, and don't worry. If you fail, people will tell you, never bother about what others are going to tell you. If once that question comes to your mind, you will go into the shell and you will never do things what you like to do. You do what you are good at and have faith in yourself. When we started this dairy business, people used to tell, ye dudh ka business kya hai? Because aap agar dekhne jaoge, to milk business kya subah subah hum dekhte hain, kis type ke logon se hum deal karte hain. So there is no ethical values, but humne isko is tarike se liya ke bhai tum jab aankh khologe uske pehle hum hamara business karke baith jayenge. So whatever it is there, have faith. I am strong believer of God, so have faith in God. Whatever happens, it happens for good. So have faith, have courage, and go ahead. Failure will come definitely. If it doesn't come, then you are not successful. That's what I wish. And kabhi ghabrana nahi chahiye failure se. Sirf ghabrana aur jo cheez apne hath mein nahi hai, jaise to avoid death is not in our hands. Definitely. So then why do you worry? Just go on, do, give best 100%, 1000%, whatever you can do. Rest everything, leave it to God. And do it with full heart. As you asked your question, कि हमको पूरे दिल से जवाब देना चाहिए. बिल्कुल दिल से यही जवाब है कि आप अपने पूरे दिल से काम करो. कुछ भी चिंता मत करो.
All right. Success is not in ever rising. It's in rising every time we fall. So on this note, I'd like to conclude the panel discussion. Thanks a lot for being with us, and thanks a lot all the panelists for sharing their views. Thanks a lot.
The panel discussion was indeed brainstorming. We would like to take a minute to thank all our panelists.
First, thank you, Mr. Ankit Kanchal, for sharing your views. I'm sure that the business strategy of making the first move will be helpful for all our participants.
Thank you, Mr. Nand Kishore Atal. Your philosophy, Grahak Mera Devta Hai. Hospitality is a virtue we all would like to inculcate from you.
Thank you, Mr. Vishal Agarwal, for giving your valuable expertise. I'm sure that the dynamics of your business, of handling both bottom and the upper line, will be helpful for all our participants.
Thank you, Ms. Dattani. You've set an example before all the aspiring women entrepreneurs here. We'll always remember your thought, jo dikhta hai, wahi bikta hai. We would also like to thank our moderator, Mr. Amit Bhale Rao, for conducting such an enthralling session. I request all the guests to kindly proceed to the seminar hall.